This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Welcome to Dreamland. This week, we're going in three directions at once. Back in time to an extraordinary UFO event, very controversial, as most of the big ones are. Forward in time to our own future and to another world. We're going to experience something about the Pleiadian connection. A lot of new material has surfaced. This happened many years ago, Billy Meier, and we're going to learn all about it. And we're going to learn from one of the masters of the whole field, Britt Elders. Britt is with us. She has just completed a new version of UFO Contact from the Pleiades. You will remember the book very well. It is the book full of extraordinary photos taken by Billy Meier, and it remains one of the most controversial of all of these stories. Britt has studied it and been involved from the beginning with Billy, and probably knows more about this than anyone else in the world. We're going to talk about Billy, his photos, his experience, the world of the Pleiadians as Britt has come to understand it. And I'll tell you a story of my own about them, because I had contact with one of them with no question about what he was. That's what he was. At least he could speak telepathically, and he was said that's where he was from. And I had no reason to disbelieve him, and he could have walked down the street and not been noticed as anything unusual. Welcome, Britt. I'm so excited. We're going to have a great time.
I am too, Whitley. This is wonderful. We've crossed paths in the past, but it's nice to finally meet.
Well, you're very close to Shirley MacLean, as I know. Yes. And Shirley and Anne and I were friends for a long time. Annie and Shirley were, I remember spending long evenings with the two of them at Jeffrey's restaurant on the Pacific Coast Highway, way out overlooking the Pacific as the sunset, and talking about, listening to them basically talk about the world and all of its meaning and the dark and the light, and what wonderful conversations I was privy to.
Mm-hmm. I can imagine.
But I was definitely the second fiddle, the observer.
Two wonderfully intelligent women. Had to be
they
fabulous.
Certainly were, and I lost my Annie too early.
Yes.
But Shirley's still going. She's still, what's she doing lately? She's
90 years old. She's doing very well. She's got a book coming out in October. She just finished a movie, and she has two more movies to do this year. So she is very active, on top of things, very interested in life, keeping herself together, curious as ever, always asking questions, which I adore about her. She's so
That's
great
wonderful.
In that respect. Yeah, she's doing so well.
Well, we drifted apart after Annie passed away, and I wonder why. I think she and Annie, she was mostly interested in Annie more than me. But and with good reason, because she saw what a brilliant person Annie was, and how she had created the whole communion experience. And, you know, she did. I mean, she was really on top of it. Anne was, as soon as Anne understood what had happened, she was going. She took control of it, and it became Anne's project. And now I am going down to Rice University in a few weeks to go to the archive that Annie created of all 4,000 of the letters, the best archive of contact experience in the world, created by that wonderful lady right behind me. You can see her, folks.
Yeah.
And the other painting is by a brilliant young artist called Liberty Noakes, by the way. People ask me about that from time to time. Anyway, I will be, they have all been digitized and they will soon be available for use as soon as they're, each one has to be individually anonymized. And that takes a long time because they can't be publicly available or even available to academics until we have a completely anonymized digital file.
Right.
But that's on the way. It's happening.
Whitley, that's so impressive because right now the world needs information. And when you have an archive like that and you're willing to open it to the public, we can't keep relying on the government to tell us what is and what isn't. We need to get out there and really do our own research and learn. And I commend you for putting something like that together. That's beautiful.
Well, visitors have said things like, it's up to you. This belongs to you.
Yeah.
They don't care about the government. They're in control of what the government does anyway, which is why 14 administrations have all refused to open the doors. The visitors are waiting for the people, to open the door from our side.
Exactly.
Otherwise, the door stays closed. They're not going to be doing this through any governments. It's direct.
No, and that's why putting together something like this, a library of so much information, is so valuable. We need it for everything, because everyone that has had an experience needs to come forward, explain it so that people can understand it, learn from it, and move forward with it.
Yes.
And until we open up, we aren't going to have contact on a mass scale.
Right. Yeah, that's what people learn. That a lot of people are just very passive and they sit waiting for the government. And the government, even if the government tells us something, they're not going to tell us what we need to know, which is how to live in such a way that our lives are meaningful to the visitors and their lives are meaningful to us.
Absolutely. Believe
me, no one working in the government knows the answer to that question. That answer is going to come out of us, and mm-hmm. it's going to come out of those letters, and it's going to come out of our lives. That's where it's coming from. I mean, we are in contact, not the government.
That's right. And governments have a tendency to put forth this, oh, there might be something there, and then take it back 2 weeks later. We don't need that confusion. We need to figure out what's going on in our own hearts relating to what is happening in the world in truth.
Well, yeah, and especially because they've got all these patents, that they've patented all of this stuff illegally, because you can't patent. You have to patent something you developed, not something you found.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, if you find a remarkable, unusual object of some kind,
mm-hmm.
and you figure a use for it, you can't patent it. The object, you can only patent your design.
Right.
And that's not what happened. They patented these other designs as if they were their own when they were actually found. And the whole defense industry has got those patents. I know one man in the defense industry, a couple, who have the patents personally and make money from them, and they're totally illegal. I said to one of them, what are you going to do? He said, well, I'll move. I'll leave the country. And I thought to myself, amplify that by thousands and a bunch of big companies, and you very well understand why the defense industry prevailed upon the Congress to emasculate the Schumer Amendment.
Mm-hmm.
And they did that. That came from the defense industry, and they did it because they cannot afford that to come out.
Right.
Because if it does, then they're all in trouble. They owe a lot of money, and they don't intend to pay.
Right.
Okay, let's get on to something fun. We've been diving, kvetching, and now I want to talk first, before we go on, a little bit about the controversy so that we can really get into the true story.
Sure.
Now, there was a lot of controversy, of course, about Billy Meier and what he said, and whether or not the images are real and so forth and so on. Can you give us some idea of what those controversies were and some of the players in that?
Yeah.
I know that one man, I've forgotten his name, found models of the UFOs at Billy Meier's house.
Well, I would love it if he would bring those forward, because we had people saying, oh, I saw models there, but nobody brought them forward. During the course of a 7-year investigation into this case, my husband Lee and I spent over 365 days living at the farm. Billy gave us free rein and everything. We walked through every inch of that farm. We went through everything that was present in the residence and on the property. And at no time did we ever see a model or anything that people could even construe as a model. So that was interesting. But this was way back in the 70s, 76, 77. The contacts began in 75. By the time we got in 76, there was already a great accumulation of photographs. One particular individual said, oh, he found a line in the photograph, which must have been the string supporting a model. Others just did not like the fact that it was a contact. It was a willing face-to-face communication. At that point in time, things were going on like Betty and Barney Hill, and your experience, of course, was happening. The Walden case, Bill Walden. No, Travis Walton, not the basketball player. And all of that was happening. And so people were locked into, it's a one-time happenstance occurrence. That wasn't true. There were contacts happening, and there have been for a long, long time. So we had all of this type of thing. And then people just got into the aspect that we weren't UFO investigators. Well, they were correct. We had a company called Intercept. Intercept was designed basically to prevent Fortune 500s and financial institutions from being eavesdropped and wiretapped. So yes, we had an investigative background. We didn't want to throw our company into the toilet by associating it with UFOs, which back in the 70s was a taboo subject.
Yeah, your company would have been folded up and put in a drawer or a trash can. Mile 13, here you came.
Yes, definitely. But we did have some business in London, and we decided to go over and check out this case. When we got there, we expected, okay, we can go through this quickly. We'll debunk it. We'll get back home, get back to work. We got there and Billy opened everything to us. He gave us photographs, movie footage, metal samples from the skin of the craft, audio recordings of the craft. We interviewed a few dozen witnesses. A week later, we came back with a lot of information that really needed to be examined. But people were unhappy with the fact that we weren't involved with UFO culture at that time. And we thought, no, if you're investigating murder one, counter espionage, or a UFO case, you apply the same criteria. And that's how we approached it.
I know what you mean when you get that kind of hostility, because
yes,
I came, as far as the UFO people were concerned, out of nowhere.
Yeah.
The reason being, I guess the visitors were interested in what I could do for them, I don't know if they know the UFO community even existed. So I had the same problem. I was an outsider. In fact, I'm still an outsider. I haven't been invited once to a MUFON national convention. I am still sound on a grotto with MUFON after all these years, and I always will be. They do not forget.
No. I consider me on the outside too. I mean, I have a lot of friends in the community. We exchange a lot of information, explore different topics. But as far as being invited to a major MUFON conference, that's never happened, and I don't think it ever will.
No, I don't think it does well either. Yeah, I'm the same way. I go to MUFON, local MUFONs all the time and talk to them on Zoom and so forth. But the national group is still very much controlled by nuts and bolts, old-fashioned. I don't want to criticize them anymore. They're there and they've done a lot.
Yes, they have.
They really have. And let's leave it at that and go on to something else. Now, here's the question I have. What interested you in the first place? You guys aren't in the UFO community. Did you see something or what happened?
Well, when we first saw the photographs, we said they're too good to be true. There's just no way that this whole case can be real. And then when we had the opportunity to sit down and look at hundreds and hundreds of photographs with Meier and all of the other evidence that he presented to us, we just knew somebody had to look into it and look into it from the standpoint of taking it to qualified individuals with qualified equipment that had a reputation for excellence and could actually examine these things. We knew we didn't have that capability. So through Intercept and other connections, we were able to get into various labs and really have it, the information examined thoroughly. And that's what we wanted to do. But I have to say, once you're involved with the subject matter, you are in over your eyes. It's just, it consumes you. You keep going, you want more and more and more. And every time we thought, we've got this answered. We know how it's all set up and everything, and we go to test. No, there were more questions, hundreds and hundreds of more questions. So you can't just stop with one individual saying, oh, this is really interesting. It digitizes very well when they're looking at a photograph. And you got to go further. Well, what does that digitization mean? What does it mean when you compare it to a tree standing right next to this craft? What does it mean distance-wise? How big is the object? All of that comes into play. And so you keep progressing down the road of investigation until you get some real answers.
So you did the same. The same thing happens to everybody. I don't know a single person in this field who wasn't drawn into it by something like what happened to you.
Yeah.
You went to Billy Meier expecting that he was a kind of a goof, and it turned out that he was not.
Right.
Do you know, let me ask you, well, you know, it's time for us to take our first break.
Okay.
Now that the free part of Dreamland runs only half an hour, I'm hoping that it'll encourage someone to subscribe again, because I'm probably looking at the last few years of Unknown Country and Dreamland now, because I just don't have subscribers. But anyway, we'll be right back.
Okay.
Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. UnknownCountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition, very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us, because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me, it's the first time in the whole life of communion that it has been read in full in audio format. And believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it. And I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get communion. Listen to it. Read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives.
I want to let you know that Britt is going to be with us in the subscriber video chat room on August the 17th at 10 a.m. Pacific. That's 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern. So get ready with your questions for Britt. She probably knows more about Billy Meier and the Pleiadian experience than anyone in the world. Don't miss this unique opportunity to question her directly. And if you're not a subscriber, now surely is the time to go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe. We're talking to Britt Elders. Britt has republished UFO Contact from the Pleiades, excuse me, folks, volumes 1 and 2 in a marvelous new book. You can see the cover right there as we're speaking. And it is got a foreword by Shirley MacLaine, Jaime Masson, and it provides an introduction, and all of these great images of from Billy are here. And I'm looking at one right now. One of the big things was always, they're near trees.
Yeah.
Therefore, they must be models that are held up in some way. But the images where they're free in the air, not near trees, and there are plenty of those. Did you ever find any sign of any strings or anything? Because I'm quite sure you looked.
No, all of the images that we had digitized, that was the first thing you look for. Because when you digitize a photograph, you will see anything unusual in it, including a string supporting it. They all came out very, very clean. When you have it digitized and you're comparing it to the size of another object, a known object, you can determine the size. You triangulate it to get size when you have the size of a known object. They were 21 feet in diameter. It would have taken a very big string to support it. Now, I will say this. We, as investigators, contacted Wally Gentleman. He was a special effects expert. He worked with Kubrick. He worked with Coppola and many, many others. We had him make a model for us, and we hung it from a string so we could take photographs of that model and compare it to the photographs that Billy took. We found the string in our images, but we never found a string in Meier's images. One of the best pictures I think he took was taken on April 6th in 1976, I think it was. And it shows a Mirage jet fighter in the same scene as this UFO. The interesting thing was there was sound taken during that same sequence that Billy had a tape recorder going. And when that sound was analyzed, you could hear the Mirage fighter. You could hear a police siren in the background and a dog barking. So that just, it adds to the validity of Meier's claims.
Well, the fact that there were so many photographs also, and yet he was very cagey about, he didn't let anyone near him. Why was that?
The Pleiadians told him that they would break off the contact if he tried to bring anyone with him. So that was something that, you know, they just did not allow for whatever reason. But they
did. I know the reason.
Go ahead.
This has to be kept in question until a certain time.
Yeah.
And all of it has to be kept in question. We are here to do what you're doing. which is to pick it apart, analyze it, try to understand it on our own. This is about a new world if we can take it. It's not about a new world being given to us. And that's why that is the whatever reason, and it is true across the board. That is why there are so few, for example, images, real images of the Greys. I've seen the Greys quite a few times, and therefore I'll know immediately whether or not an image is real. Mm-hmm. And there's very few of them. Yeah. And okay, so but anyway, let's go on. Tell us about you did some analysis. Did you do some analysis of the metal?
Yes.
What was the outcome?
The metal was very interesting. It was analyzed at IBM Laboratories with Dr. Marcel Vogel. He put it under a spectrum microscope and took it apart. What he found were two very interesting things. The metal was metal, and then a crystalline structure and more metal. So pieces of metal were separated by crystal. That in itself was very unusual because at that time, we only poured metal. We heated it and we poured
yes.
it. And now we have the ability, after all these years, to do cold fusion. But that metal was done in a cold fusion process. That was number one. Number two was that the metal contained thulium, which is a rare earth element, very costly to extract, and very hard and difficult to find. How would a man with one arm, a fifth grade education, worldly, but no education as we think of it, how would he know to find thulium and incorporate it into a metal? And how could he create a cold fusion process when our scientists couldn't do it?
So I think we can safely conclude that this wasn't done by him.
That's right.
Was there ever any isotopic analysis done on it?
Not at that time. No, they didn't have all of the different things that they needed to do it.
Yes.
The metals,
has there been any more recently?
No, there hasn't. When
it's very expensive.
Yes, it is. Yeah, I've been looking into where do I go with this now? Because I'm bringing people up to date with something that did happen 40 years ago with the equipment and the technology we had 40 years ago. But what do we have now? And so I'm looking at, okay, now where can we go with it from here? Not that to me it matters, because when you use the equipment of the day to test, then you're at the point you can go no further. Yeah.
That's right. Yeah. And you obviously went as far as you could.
Yeah.
Then. Some of the art's parts have been tested for isotopes and found to have isotopes that can't exist in this universe. But
wow.
In other words, the isotopes had to have been either it's from a parallel universe, or the isotopes had to have been manufactured mm-hmm. at great expense. And I say expense, I mean energy expense, because it would be very energy intensive to do that.
Right.
So, and I would be fascinated to find whether or not this metal is isotopically normal, or if it's the isotopes are unusual. That's why I asked the question. Okay, now one of the other things is that there were many people in the area who had unusual experiences of various kinds.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but before we go there, we're going to take our last break for the free side. We'll be right back.
Who are they? Why are they here? What do they want with us? Why is it all so secret? All of these questions are explored in my new book, Them, in an entirely new way. What do Close Encounter reports tell us about what the visitors want with us? What is the military's experience? And can our memories be trusted? Can anything be trusted?
them answers all of these questions in a totally new way. It's available in hardcover, softcover, as a Kindle, and as an audiobook, read by me. Get them today, and you can get it from the unknowncountry.com store, signed by me. We're back. We're talking to Britt Elders, her website, brittelders.com. Her new book is a reissue 45th anniversary edition of UFO Contact from the Pleiades, Volume 1 and 2. It is an amazing, beautiful book full of color illustrations, and you can listen here and hear the actual solidity of this case. There's a lot to the case, and it is, why do you think, Britt, it has been so roundly, and we'll get to the other witnesses in a minute, so intensely debunked? It's almost as if there's a professional level of debunking going on. It's more than just the usual trolls sneering because their egos are out of shape. It's more. This has been really worked over. Why is that, do you think? And who's doing it?
It's very interesting, and it's a great question. I don't know who's doing it. I know that we had access to labs such as the Groton Naval Connecticut facility. We had access to JPL, Scripps Institute, Ames Research, IBM. We were in labs that the government was involved with. I think more than anything, it was an outside group that was just sort of pushing against everything that was coming out that was good, that people could learn from. Who they were, I'm not sure. I really don't know. And I do know this. The biggest problems we had, truthfully, were from the UFO groups. And they did not want us involved at all.
Because you weren't in their world.
Right.
Well, did I mention before on the show that I have had contact with one of the Pleiadians? I don't think so. I did mention it.
Just briefly. Okay.
Briefly. Okay, well, here's this. I'm not going to go into great detail about it, folks. Most of it was over the telephone. There was enough happened for me to be absolutely certain that this man was what he said he was. And I'm not going to go into the details about that. But I am going to go into one detail about the things he said. He said, and I'm quoting him now, that if you start a war with the Greys, they will never let you win, and they will never let you stop fighting.
Ugh.
And he was not friendly about them.
Uh-huh.
He was uncomfortable, let's put it that way. And I think that someone in this country did start a war with the Greys. The U.S. Air Force has. Not the Navy, but the Air Force. And I think the Greys look upon the Air Force as fighting them, not other parts of the country, not all of us. They don't have that vision. They see it as a single, you know, in other words, if jets are coming and shooting at them, then they see the jets as the enemy.
Uh-huh.
And therefore, it's the Air Force that can't beat them and can't stop fighting.
Wow.
That's probably one of the major reasons for the secrecy. Now, the other side of the coin is he did not like the Greys because he felt like they were too controlling, I guess would be the best word to put it.
Mm-hmm.
And that that we should be very careful. I should be personally. He was concerned about the reason I was having this contact with him. Is he was concerned about my relationship with the Greys.
Uh-huh.
And he was warning me about, you know, how to keep my own counsel, not believe them, and basically saying that I had to remain my own man or I would get sucked up in something I could never escape.
Wow.
So And as I say, he was real. Now, the interesting thing about him, he had a definite connection to the United States government. So he was working through the Defense Department. Mm-hmm. And part of it that apparently is deep into this, and none of the whistleblowers I've heard, David Grosham, Lou Elizondo, and so on, have ever mentioned a word about this aspect of it. So I don't think they know about it. And I don't even think that it's even still going, I don't know if it's even still going on.
Uh-huh.
But it is real. And now when we go on, we're going to start talking about this whole issue of what are these conflicts, and how do we relate to that? And also, we're going to go into some of the things that happened to other people, which I started to do and then got sidetracked on. And I'm now supposed to end the show at 30 minutes in a desperate attempt to get people to subscribe, because we're running out of steam now, and I'm going to be pulling out in about a year, it looks like, right now. So if you want to keep it going, subscribe now. And thank you very much for listening, Free Dreamlanders. I hope to see you next week. And please don't put a lot of ugly things up in the comments on YouTube, because we're doing it this way. We have no choice, or we wouldn't be. We'll see you next week.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.